Tonight on The Mole, we'll reunite the players and show you how the mole outwitted them all.
Jim is the mole.
Catherine's the mole.
I'm gonna have to just go with Steve.
We'll also show you some clues that would have helped you, as well as the players, figure out the mole's identity.
Aha!
Tonight, one of these three players will be the winner of $510,000, and one will be revealed as the mole.
Oh my
no!
God!
No!
Previously on The Mole, it all began in the California desert.
Okay, will the real mole please step forward?
Three of you wanted to be in the finals together, and you have gotten your wish.
Who's the mole? Wait, aren't you forgetting someone?
Final episode, final execution. I'm either gonna be gratified or duped.
10 strangers playing for up to $1 million. Among them, a saboteur, a traitor, the mole. The winner? The one who answers the question, who is the mole?
Well, welcome back. It's good to see all you. You're all cleaned up and rested, and you all look much happier, I must admit. This is actually the first time you've all been together as a group since each of you were executed. This is the first time you've seen each other and been able to talk to each other, and I know Charlie, I think you told us there were some things you wanted to say to Kate, maybe?
Actually, I think I owe a...
Oh, yeah.
I think everybody here knows what I owe. But I want to say sincerely to Kate that I really, in retrospect, I'm very, very sorry that I gave you a hard time during the game. Lost my temper on one occasion during one of the tests. Obviously used some inappropriate verbiage.
They bleeped it out.
Fortunately, I think that you were really a good troop of playing the game tremendously, and you and I should have got along a lot better, and I hope we can let bygones be bygones.
It was okay? All part of the game. Okay.
And I also have to say that you look terrific.
This is what grandmothers look like now.
This is grandmother. All right, now I want to ask each of you two important questions. One, who do you think is the mole, and who do you think is the winner? Manuel?
Catherine's the mole. Mm-hmm. I think she's the mole.
And who do you think won the money?
I think Jim.
Okay, Afi?
I agree with you in the fact that Jim did win the money. However, in terms of who the mole is, I'm going to have to go with Steven because the Colorado connection, I'm feeling his mole.
You think Steve is the mole and you think Jim won the money?
Exactly.
Wendy?
Well, I think that Steve or Catherine, either one, but I'm going to have to just go with Steve and then give Catherine the winnings.
Henry?
I totally side with Wendy. I think Steve is the mole and I think Catherine is the winner.
I think you're all wrong. I think my buddy Jim is the mole, and I think Steven took the money home.
I think Steven's the mole, and I think Jim won. But it was really close with Catherine, because both of them were very good players.
And Charlie?
Well, I'm not picking any of these people. So. Actually, I thought that Catherine was the mole, and I believe that Jim, being her close buddy, had the big advantage and became the winner.
How many of you tried, at one point or another, to pretend to be the mole?
I didn't exactly try. I just enhanced my inabilities, particularly in the running area.
Remember the first part?
I suspected you, Kate.
All right, well, definitely Sabotage was the name of the game, and no one did it better than our mole. And coming up in a few moments, you and the people at home are going to find out who the mole's eighth victim is. We'll be right back.
If a green thumbprint appears after your name has been entered, you are either the winner of $510,000 or you're the mole. If a red thumbprint appears, you are the mole's eighth victim.
Oh my God!
Here are the results of the ABC.com poll asking who you think is the mole.
Welcome back to the final episode of The Mole. We've reunited seven of the players, and now there are three players left: Jim, Catherine, and Steven. Any one of them could be the mole.
Let's take a look now at just a few of their suspicious moments. Three players remain in the game, all of them suspicious, but only one of them is the mole. In a test like the hostage rescue, time is of the essence.
Jim is not with us. He is not here as of yet.
So was Jim killing time?
They can't find Jim.
My suspicions of who the mole is coming correct.
You have to find this book.
In the carriage library test, the players had to find tickets in books. But when Jim found the book that contained a ticket, he dismissed it.
This is it. You just had it. It's right
here.
That was it? Yes.
Cool.
He went directly to where the book was. And to me, it looked exactly like the book in the picture. And he said, oh, it's not here. You know, and I pulled it out, and there was the ticket.
In the dice game, Jim rolled a 5, which meant that he would have to put casts on both his legs. But when he got to the hospital, he refused his assignment.
Jim, his refusal to put 2 casts on his leg.
I'm not doing it. I'm sorry. I'm not casting my legs, man.
It's just ridiculous. I mean, who wouldn't put casts on?
With 38 minutes remaining in the Cartier watch test, Henry and Kate were confident the silver watch was a fake. But Catherine insisted on making calls to Cartier to get more information. Was she stalling for time?
No person that speaks. Okay, should we just hang up and call someone, try to call someone?
Let's get out of here.
Okay, let's go.
4, 5, or 6, shave your head.
And Catherine refused her assignment in the dice test.
I'm not gonna do it. There's no way I'm shaving my head. I'm sorry.
On the fortress test,
there was some concern about Catherine being in the middle.
The guy got in, ran through a window, and was apparently shot at by Catherine on a strange angle to me that points that she missed on purpose.
During the hostage rescue, we called him at one point and asked if he could hear the helicopter because we were trying to pinpoint if we were in the right area.
I can't hear you because of the helicopter now.
And we weren't even in the right town.
Again, in the dice test, Steven refused his assignment.
1, 2, or 3, paint a nude portrait, or 4, 5, or 6, pose nude.
The whole refusing to pose nude, I thought that seemed odd.
I don't want to do this. I can't do it.
Particularly when I met his wife, when she came here, and she said she would have posed nude.
If you say it's Catherine, we'll go in that direction.
In the three questions test, the players had to locate Steven by guessing how he answered three questions. But when they got to the location, Steven wasn't there.
What went wrong? Steve answered some questions randomly.
I went down on the list. I went Jim, Catherine, all the way down the list, back and forth.
To do it randomly makes no sense at all.
All right, well, it's time right now to take a look and find out who's the mole's eighth victim. Let's take a look.
In the last episode, we left our players, Jim, Catherine, and Steven, in the bull ring in Ronda, Spain, where they took their final quiz. Afterwards, they were sequestered, then brought in one at a time to get their results.
When you're ready to begin, I'll enter your name into the computer. As you know, if a green thumbprint appears after your name has been entered, you are either the winner of $510,000 or you're the mole. If a red thumbprint appears,
You are the mole's eighth victim, and you have to take your bag and leave the game. Are you ready? Okay.
I just voted for you. I said, who do you think the winner was? And I said, Jim.
Well, that's what I thought too. But
Jim played a great game. Now it's down to two, Stephen and Catherine. Who wins the $510,000? Who's the mole? We'll find out in a moment. Welcome back. There are two players left, Stephen and Catherine. One of them is the winner of $510,000, and one of them is the mole. It is finally time to find out. Let's return to the bullring 4 months ago. Remember, Catherine and Stephen do not know that Jim has already lost. So you know how this works. When you tell me you're ready, I'll enter your name into the computer. If a green thumbprint appears after your name has been entered, you are either the mole or the winner of $510,000. If a red thumbprint appears after your name has been entered, you are the mole's eighth and final victim. You have to take your bag and leave the game immediately.
Congratulations, Stephen. You've just won the game.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Oh!
Congratulations. Nice job. I think by your reaction, you know you won $510,000. Way to go. Are you ready to meet your adversary? Let's bring in the mole.
I can't believe that.
Catherine, you did great.
Thanks, Anderson.
I don't know how I beat him. Seriously, I was sure, because there was a couple questions. I don't know.
It feels good to win $510,000.
It's not too bad.
I bet it must.
Well, I don't know what to say. I've never won. Okay, I got it. I can't believe that.
All right, well, congratulations. Great job. You, amazing.
Thank you.
Amazing job. Let's, go and figure out some ways to spend your money. You're buying dinner.
Hi, guys. How are you? I said it
for you. Really good job, man.
So
awesome job.
How are you?
How are you?
Yes.
Thank you.
Wow.
I just want to tell you, I did not know who the mole was during the entire course of the game. I'd sort of figured it out with a couple of days to go, but you did just an excellent, excellent job.
Now,
Steve, how did you think you did on the final quiz?
Oh, I was sure that Jim won. Mm-hmm. I mean, I knew I was going to be executed. I just had that feeling, and I was comfortable with that.
Now, just so the rest of you know, the final quiz was incredibly difficult. It had 25 questions going all the way back to the very beginning of the game. Jim, how many did you think you got right?
Three. I mean, we actually talked about the fact that we thought it was going to go back to the beginning, but the questions were really difficult.
Just so you know, on the final quiz, out of 25 questions, Jim, you got 13 correct, and Stephen, you got 16 correct. So it was actually very close. Were you surprised by who the mole was, Henry?
Yeah, definitely surprised. I thought it was going to be vice versa. I thought it was going to be Steve the mole and Catherine as the winner.
Okay, Kate, also you.
I had picked completely wrong. Catherine from the first two quizzes. I just went all the way with her. I just had a premonition. Every little indication went that way. But she played it so well that she went undercover really well. Mm. and I just switched.
Now, Charlie, I see a little smile on your face from satisfaction from knowing you guessed from day one.
From day one, I picked Catherine, and I was waiting to see some overt or covert act on her part to really solidify it, and I never really got it, but I never got one from anyone else, so I stayed with her right to the end.
Well, how did Steven beat out all of his competitors and win the game? And how did Catherine fool so many of them for so long? We'll find out when we come back.
The hardest part of being the mole has been when I know that somebody is not on to me, and I know that they're going to lose.
So Catherine Price is the mole, and it's pretty surprising because she's not an actress. In fact, she is a lawyer from Chicago, just as we said she was, and she auditioned for the show just like everyone else. Congratulations, you did an amazing job.
Thank you.
What was the most difficult thing about being the mole?
The most difficult thing was that I could never be myself. I had to lie 24 hours a day. I even had to lie in my interviews, in my confessional, in my journal.
You're a lawyer, aren't you used to it?
Yeah. Great preparation.
No, seriously, but that was the
hardest part, definitely. I mean, the very hardest part was lying in my journal. I was terrified someone would find my journal and read it, so I wrote it as a player, and I would have to make up suspicions that I had for other players and talk about how nervous I was about getting executed. Mm. And you
know. It's really tough because, I mean, over the course of the game, people became pretty close, and it's got to be hard not to, you know, to become close to people, yet not to really fully be yourself.
I'm sure everyone feels that to some degree because everyone is trying to win, and you're wanting to maybe throw suspicion onto yourself. So in some ways, I'm just like everyone else. But yeah, I felt that I had an extra burden.
All right. Well, we've actually put together some clips of some of your more difficult moments. Are you ready?
God. Yeah.
All right, let's take a look.
It all starts with your final confession.
I'm confessing my biggest sin, that I am the mole. It seems weird to say it out loud because I've never said it out loud. I didn't anticipate how hard it would be to just lie constantly, constantly, never be myself. Or, you know, I mean, I was myself, but a large chunk of me couldn't be revealed.
I just feel like I lost this $80,000 today.
No. The team lost.
In some way, I was rooting for the team to win money. I wanted them. I like these people. But that wasn't my job. My job was to keep them from winning money. I know Kate was on to me early. She was the hardest.
We can make it up in half an hour.
I can't. I can tell you that right now.
And I could sense the moment in our friendship when I think she decided that I was the mole. Something changed. There was like a distance there.
If I were to shoot you, I would have gotten exemption.
You don't think it's a little strange that she's the first person to raise her hand today?
I was volunteering for relaxation. I had no idea I was volunteering for this.
And then I could sense when she came back, when she switched from thinking I was the mole to thinking somebody else was. The hardest part of being the mole has been when I know that somebody is not on to me, and I know that they're going to lose.
Manuel. Manuel, please take your bag.
I'm just relieved and tired and sad for Emmanuel, I guess. I think that this game is much harder than I expected. It's much harder emotionally. It's just constantly not having someone that you think you can trust.
Do we have to do this right this second?
We don't have to do anything. Let's walk this way. Let's go.
just terrible.
That same day, in the hotel room's test, Catherine broke down from the stress of trying to maintain her cover.
I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. Like I said the other day, you've done a great job.
But I don't feel like...
It's been a rough trip.
Please forgive me if you feel I've lied to you or you believed in me falsely. It was harder on me. I'll say that. Any of you players that are out there watching this someday, please know that it was harder on me.
Well, being the mole, as you know, was really no simple task. I mean, you did just an amazing job, and it required probably attention to detail like every second of the day, I would imagine, and the constant lies and deception obviously, you know, weighed heavily on you. You handled it really, really well.
Thanks.
So, you know, some of you were on to Catherine really from the beginning, Kate, Charlie especially. Was there anything particular that set you off?
Mine was an intuition thing, and picking up clues that weren't really clues. Like, her room was always closest to reception, so I figured that the producers could get to her the easiest without going by everybody else's room, keeping track of room numbers, things like that that turned out to be totally ridiculous.
But Charlie, no one really believed you when you said that you were sticking to one person, that you were just going for Catherine. A lot of people didn't believe you, and it wasn't until later that some people started to follow that path as well. Let's take a look at this.
From the very first day, only one of the 10 players suspected Catherine of being the mole.
I have selected an individual right from the beginning, and I'm staying with that individual until I get some message from somebody and takes me away from Catherine. Otherwise, I'm sticking with Catherine.
Most of the other players, however, were not quite as insightful as Charlie.
Princess Catherine. Priceless. Love her. So far, she has not failed at anything.
Catherine is very low under the radar, and if she is the mole, she's letting everybody else do the work for her.
Catherine, I don't believe, is the mole. My hunch is that she's not. But there's something about Catherine when she talks, it seems very genuine.
I looked Catherine right in the face and I said, "You ain't the mole."
Yeah. All right, now, Stephen, after getting information from Charlie, you were pretty sure of the mole's identity. You pretty much decided it was Catherine. But your strategy was probably the most complex of anybody's. You developed a friendship with Catherine. Did that help?
I wanted to sort of be close to everybody, because I wanted information, and that was the best way I could elicit it.
Well, during the game, a lot of people said you were kind of a flirt, kind of a schmoozer, kind of playing.
What you're talking about?
Playing,
that's a blatant lie.
I'll show you what we're talking about. A lot of people said you were kind of playing Mr. Nice Guy.
And the camera doesn't lie.
We've actually assembled some of the more flirtatious moments, shall we say.
Divorce court.
Let's take a look.
Here comes the judge.
He's flirtatious.
I think Steve is definitely playing a game. I think he plays it with all of the women here. I think he tries to use sort of his flirting and charm to, I don't know if it's to throw you off the track or throw you on the track.
There's moments that I think he's flirting with me. I'm not even sure what that game is. I mean, I'm gay, everybody knows it.
Good looking, he's a good looking man, and he's got a lot of great things going for him. But what has bothered me is that he kind of goes from person to person and kind of tries to suck what they're thinking about the game and who they are considering out of them.
Steve's so sweet, and he looks at you, and you have to believe what he's telling you.
I'm just trying to be nice to everybody, that's all.
He just won't admit it. He's a flirt.
I taught you well.
Steve, yeah, you
seem to. I taught you well.
Steve, after I told you what the mole was, you weren't nice to me after that.
I didn't do anything to say.
Wendy, was
served your purpose, Charlie.
Was Steve really that flirtatious?
Oh, I think he definitely was. He didn't flirt with me. I wasn't going
to
go there with him.
She wouldn't let me get close to her.
No way.
Steve, do you have anything you want to say about it?
Nothing.
No? So probably what a lot of you didn't realize was also how ruthless Steven was in playing the game. By the second day, he and Jim had created a coalition, but he continued to foster friendships with all of you in order to gain information. Let's take a look.
The nature of this game is one that there can never be complete trust. And if that complete trust is given, your eyes have to be open to the risk that you are taking.
We've come upon the strategy of divide and conquer, where I will push people his way, make them think that he is the mole and he will do the same for me.
The hostage rescue test was the beginning of Steven's coalition with Jim. Whenever the group calls Steven, Jim did the talking. They had already formed a bond.
Steve, give me some things that you can hear around you, where you are right now or where you think you are.
As a rule, Steven and Jim would split up during the test. Steven often teamed up with Charlie in order to get information. And Jim developed a friendship with Jennifer.
Go right. Run straight, fast!
They were so convincing that Charlie and Jennifer thought they'd begun their own coalitions with Steven and Jim.
Steven and I, both having a law enforcement background, have bonded a little bit.
If I had to rely on somebody or trust someone, Steve would be the one that I would rely on and trust.
Jim and I are definitely working in cahoots together. I just know I trust him implicitly, and I think he feels the same about me.
Because both Steven and Jim sabotaged the dice test.
You couldn't wear two casts?
Struggling up and down the hill.
And you couldn't pose nude?
Many of the others naturally suspected that one of them was the mole.
I love my boy Jim, but he's spending a lot of time with Steve, so it makes me a little bit leery.
Jim encouraged Jennifer to believe that I'm the mole. In effect, Jim took Jennifer out of the game.
Jennifer.
Bummer.
I like Jen.
Jen and I were really tight, but the game is about the use of information and the manipulation of information. I don't think Jen ever realized that I was more of Steve's ally than I was her.
With Jennifer and the other players already executed, Charlie was the coalition's last victim.
Let me give it a go.
He's walking the plank, basically.
Charlie is to Steve, in a way, as Jen was to me.
In the trust test, Charlie helped Steven get the exemption that would land him in the final round. Little did he know, his friend was out to get him.
Charlie put himself up against the buzzsaw, and he knows it, and I know it.
The next loser is going to be the person who votes the wrong way on the next quiz, or at least one more question wrong than I do. Obviously, I'm not going to be doing that to Steve, so it's Charlie at this point.
Charlie, please take your bag.
The person who initially turned me on to Catherine was Charlie. I feel some guilt that he's gone because it probably should have been me.
Although Steven and Jim's coalition appeared strong, in the days leading up to the final quiz, Jim began to waver in his belief that Catherine was the mole.
I don't know. Maybe Catherine's not the mole. Maybe Steve is, and he's playing me. Who knows? I mean, a stupid game that gets you so wound up.
What if Steve's tricking you? What if? It's life. It's the game. It's how you play it. There's so much second guessing. The game comes down to this moment, the final quizzes.
When it came to the final round, the partners were up against each other. According to the quiz rules, whoever got more questions right would win. In the case of a tie, whoever finished first would take home the money. While Jim was still afraid that Steven might be the mole, Steven's only worry was that Jim would beat him on the quiz, and he brilliantly plotted his partner's final demise.
What I'm doing is telling Jim I'm going to go as fast as I can, and hopefully he'll try and go faster and make a mistake in there.
And that is exactly what happened.
Well, you two guys have slunk down in your seats a fair amount. I noticed. How did you guys know you could trust each other to form this coalition?
It was strange. I mean, I'm speaking for myself, but when we shook hands, we both kind of made this kind of like, look, this is what I'm about. And, you know, this game is whatever. But I'm shaking your hand, and this is my word that, you know, we're going to go through with this. And I guess we kind of both lucked out that we were both kind of on the same page, you know, with that kind of philosophy, that we were both able to transcend the game and make that promise to each other, and it worked out.
Catherine, did this coalition make your job harder?
In some ways, the coalition made my job harder, and in some ways, it made my job easier. Easier in that I think they attempted to shield me. I mean, I think that was the whole plan, is that they would shield me from the others. I knew they both thought that it was me. So in that sense, I could relax a little bit. I could also rely on the fact that they were going to screw up as much stuff as they could, and they screwed up a lot. And that took
was me.
Mainly Steve.
I mean, I was constantly like, what are you doing? Don't you want to make any money? What are you doing? I felt the closest to breaking Jim, just because he would engage with me more. Steve was just like, you're the mole. I'm not talking about it. Like, we're done. Let's talk about other stuff. Jim would get into it with me. And so in a way I felt, you know, I wasn't successful at all. But I thought I always had that chance.
So Stephen, what are you gonna do with the money?
I think I'm going down to Belize. Yeah. Gonna do some scuba diving.
Does your wife know that you're $510,000 richer?
No, she doesn't know.
But she does now. Angie?
Hey, sweetie.
Hi. You're a big liar.
I just wanted it to be a good surprise for you, so.
Yeah, it definitely is.
So how did the mole do it? How was the mole able to trick 8 people for so long? Well, we'll find out right after this.
Why couldn't you say the gate is right there, Kate?
The mole wants the team dynamic to break down.
So who's the mole? Well, it was Catherine. And Steven is the one person who figured out who the mole was and won the game. Now, obviously, a lot of the tests were sabotaged by Catherine, which left her open to suspicion. Let's take a look at some of those cases.
During the game, the producers would often meet with the mole to plan ways to sabotage. She provided information that would then be used as questions on the next quiz.
Steve, he wears a Timex Expedition, and Jim has no watch.
My original strategy, right, when we first met, was just to be as friendly and sort of innocent and to try to fit in, you know, maybe to reach out to a few people. To some degree, the rescue of Steve was just a comedy of errors. So I would just try to take advantage of small things to slow us down. It's always a good idea to waste time if it's a timed test.
Is it Fort Antoine?
No.
Even though I just told them that Steven wasn't there, Catherine was able to convince the group to search again.
He heard the helicopter.
Okay, I think they're there.
Okay, so let's just go up there.
If I hadn't wasted time, then Jennifer's disappearance wouldn't have made any difference.
50 big ones blown, guys.
In the dice assignment, I knew I wanted to sabotage that. The day before that, Wendy had asked me if I would ever shave my head, and I said no. So I told the producers that she had said that to me. So one of the choices in the dice game was, would you shave your head? And I maneuvered it so that I would get in the position that that was the card I received. During the sniper test, I just wanted to take myself out of the action so that the suspicion could fall on other players.
And you weren't even shooting.
I hid behind a tree. I hid behind 2 trees.
Why couldn't you say the gate is right there, Kate?
Why couldn't you tell her in the church?
The mole wants the team dynamic to break down.
When I was on the resourceful team, I just did a whole bunch of little things that added up to us failing that test. First, I knew that truck we had would break down. I had been given this information. So I allowed Steve to waste all kinds of time with that truck. Then, at one point, we passed a place that I thought was the turnoff, and I just didn't look at it. And Steve had the pictures, and I started talking to him, and he didn't notice the turnoff. We went way out of our way. So then later I could say, you know, Steve had the pictures. He was navigating. He should have noticed where we were supposed to turn. I think that my favorite, I guess, manipulation of the other players would be on the night of the fortress test. I knew that I needed to sabotage that night, and I knew that to do that, my best position would be in the center. Essentially, I just kept saying, don't put me in the center of the fortress, don't put me in the center of the fortress, like, you know, Briar Rabbit. And Jim and Steve, who I knew at that point suspected me, were gonna put me in the center of that fortress if I said I didn't want to be there. And they did it, you know, then I was able to get the secret information to the aggressors.
The interior is weak. The interior is very weak.
Part of the histrionics that you see at the end, where I'm crying and really upset, was for Kate's benefit. Because as soon as she took a motherly position with me, that would eliminate me as the mole. The way that I tried to sabotage the art test was to throw just as much junk into the piece as I could. I could tell looking at the other pieces in that gallery that they were very simple. So hence the jewels. I forced Jim to allow me to leave the jewels.
My case is that I think there should be something that is being reached for here. I like that it's just like crappy, broken material goods.
And I tried to make it seem at the time like a girly thing, and just wanted to get my way, and it wasn't sabotage, and I really wanted to win. And the Trust Me test, I was not told anything about it going in. The producers purposely didn't tell me because they wanted to see genuine fear, and they got it.
Okay, I just have to think for a second, okay?
Okay.
And then when I got up, I thought, God, now if I don't do it, Steve's really gonna think that this is like the biggest sabotage he's ever seen.
I don't think I can do it.
Oh my God! In the three hotel rooms test, my goal was that we would pass the test and that I would be the hero that did it. I was given the exact details of the test beforehand by the producers, and it's a very complicated test. I actually had everything written down on a little card in my boot. I mean, there I was out in the hallway trying to subtly point Steve towards the clues that I knew were in his room. Despite the fact that I was trying to give them every clue, I could not force those guys to win any money that day. They were just sitting in their rooms, chatting on the phone like schoolgirls, so we ended up failing the test. The mole has to love it and show no mercy.
Aha. Now, there are also hidden clues which are given to you and the viewers at home. How many of these did you catch? Take a look.
The first clue was in episode one, when the players had to repack each other's bags.
Now, since the other group has already left, you're going to have to repack their bags for them. So, unfortunately, you're going to have to repack all the luggage into these rather small duffels.
Did you see the clue? Well, let's rewind that and watch it again.
So, unfortunately, you're going to have to repack all the luggage into these rather small duffels.
If you were watching closely, you would have noticed that the bag I pulled out belonged to the mole. In the Cartier watch test, Catherine had a little bit too much information.
Okay, we have to.
Okay. I'm going to have to vote for this one. Go with gut instinct.
I think we should just pull the trigger.
I'm going with the gold.
We say that this is the fake watch.
The mole just gave herself away. Let's listen to that again.
I think we should just pull the trigger, pull the trigger, pull the trigger.
How did Catherine know that they were going to pull a trigger on a gun I hadn't even told them about yet? Had you done your research during the season, you might have picked up on several hidden clues that alluded to the mole's identity. First, there are four letters in the word mole.
The question, who is the mole?
And four was the magic number. The first series of opening shots in episode one, where all the players arrive, gives you a hint. The first shot is of Jim arriving. The second shot is of Wendy arriving. The third shot, Charlie. And the fourth shot, Catherine. The mole was the fourth to arrive. The final clue in episode five tied in the mole's name with Henry being the fourth victim.
After 18 hard days, Henry paid the price. He was the mole's fourth victim.
Once again, the magic number is four. Let's hear that again.
Henry paid the price.
Henry did indeed pay the price, because the mole's name is Catherine Price.
Were there days where you just said, all right, on this test, I'm not going to do anything, or?
There were plenty of days where I said, on this test, I'm not going to do anything, because you can't sabotage every single test and expect to remain undercover. And also, it wouldn't be fun if the team never won any money. So, you know, you want them to win occasionally.
Ain't that the truth?
So, yeah, and then sometimes they would lose the money themselves. I'm like, come on, okay, I'll get in there and, you know, try to win some money. So.
Did you faint for real?
And I fainted for real. I did faint for real.
That was scary.
Yeah, it was really scary for me. And in fact, I was terrified on the parachute jump that I would faint. I thought that I might, and I was worried that I would get sent home. And luckily, I didn't faint. I have a history of fainting.
Which I knew about, yeah.
Yeah.
Charlie, would you play this game again?
I would say if you asked me that halfway through, I would have said no way. But in retrospect, now after
going through the whole thing, I would definitely give it another shot. It was really a unique experience.
Jim, what would you do differently?
I don't think I'd do anything differently.
Except maybe win.
Well, yeah, winning isn't everything.
Really, you wouldn't play the game any differently?
No, I think I played it pretty well. I mean, I got as far as I did. Maybe I would have worn the cast, so I don't know.
Jennifer, what, for you, what was the best part of the experience?
The best part of the experience was just getting on the show and to travel and meet people. I mean, I think I have some friends out of the group of 10.
When she says at dinner, if you fool me and you're the mole, I'll just say good job. I was thinking to myself, oh good, Jennifer's not gonna hate me. You know, like I was just, because that was my big thing. You know, someday all of these people will hate me.
Really?
They will all hate me, yeah. And the mole shouldn't care. That was my weakness. I shouldn't have ever cared what anyone thought.
But you were a mole with a heart.
But I shouldn't have shown him any mercy. I should have.
What was the best part of the experience for you?
Everything about it was so great. I mean, it was an experience unlike any other that I'll ever have. It was intellectually challenging and physically challenging. We got to go to great places, and it's kind of fun to pull a fast one.
Would you do it again?
Yeah, I'd do it again in a second. I'd like to play. Yeah. I'd like to play. And of course, I would always think, well, if I was playing, I would win. I would so win. You know, but probably I would be out on the first day.
Yeah. Stephen, for you, what was the best part of the experience?
That would have to be the end.
You mean winning the money?
Winning the money was a good thing. But, you know, I really enjoyed actually meeting everybody. I think I developed some strong friendships.
What advice would you give a mole in the future?
My biggest piece of advice for a future mole would really be show no mercy. When Jim says to you, swear on your mother's grave that you're not the mole, I would swear on my mother's grave that I wasn't the mole and shake his hand and do him in that day. I should have done it, and I didn't.
Anybody else? Jim, what would be your advice for the mole?
Oh, the same thing. I mean, it's a game. Yeah. Show no mercy, you know? It's, you know, I feel like I really didn't unless it was to the one person that I chose not to. You know, so it's a game. When you play, I don't know how many times I said it, when you play Monopoly or poker, you know, you show no mercy. So it's the same thing, it's a game.
All right, and so Stephen the winner walks home with a prize. Catherine the mole goes home with the satisfaction of a job well done. And the others? Well, there aren't many more stressful situations than the ones these players had to endure, surrounded by enemies and hoping against hope that the one person they trusted was not the mole. Good night, everyone.
If you would like to be a player on the next season of The Mole, log on to www.abc.com and click on The Mole for more details. That's www.abc.com.